first of all, it's a pleasure having the chance to talk to you about the impressive work you did on Wirecard, of course. Mildly put, maybe bringing down a DAX-listed company is nothing you do every day. So in my opinion, the Helmut Schmidt Award is absolutely well-deserved. So congrats to that.
Oh, well, thank you very much for that kind introduction. My name is Dan McCrum. I'm a member of the investigations at the Financial Times. And I spent the last 6 years investigating Wirecard. I started looking at this German company, which did something to do with payments and something to do with technology. Over the years, as we started trying to write about this, we encountered some of the most bizarre and outrageous tactics we'd ever seen from a company we've attempted to write about. But there were hacking, offers of bribes, attempts to manipulate the stock market, outright lying, of course, and fraud, use of surveillance, very expensive lawyers and professional advisors. And I think that the most startling thing about all of it was in 2019, when the German authorities appeared to side with Wirecard and investigate me and my colleague Stefania Palmer for market manipulation.
You started in 2015 with an article under the catchy headline, House of Wirecard. That already kind of insinuates that there is a house to be falling down sometime soon. What raised your first suspicion, and did you already then expect this outcome?
A market speculator got in touch and said some of Wirecard's numbers didn't quite make sense. And he suggested we look at, it had conducted a series of takeovers in Asia. What we found just didn't match what Wirecard was saying, the numbers weren't right, and the behavior just looked really odd. So it looked like there might be fraud, but obviously you can't just go and accuse a company of being fraudulent. So what I wrote back in 2015 was a series of posts for FT Alphaville, the FT's finance blog, which essentially raised a series of questions.
Okay, and all these questions, now we go fast forward, went in 2019, in the end, Wirecard filed for bankruptcy. In many investigations, at least in the ones I did, there might be one key moment when everything makes sense, when you just know, okay, now I got you, basically. Has there a moment like this been in this investigation over the years?
I think the key breakthrough came in late 2018 when I was approached by some whistleblowers in Singapore. They essentially told us this story of wrongdoing by various people in Wirecard's finance department. And for the first time, we had real insight, thanks to these whistleblowers, of what was happening inside the company.
I mean, there are always obstacles to investigative journalism, to reporting. So the opposite side will threaten you, mostly legally, of course, maybe also through going over your head, talking to superiors.
There were moments when it felt extremely stressful. What Wirecard did very effectively was to demonize the Financial Times and accuse me of being corrupt. But at the same time, we would fall back on this sense that we knew we were dealing with a criminal enterprise here. And so while the tactics were intimidating, they were also motivating.
There was little to none critical coverage of Wirecard for a long time in the German media. What do you think? Why did the German press more or less fail to cover the story? Why did it need someone from London to dig that up?
Perhaps it was that culture aspect, which meant that it did take an outsider to sort of raise the alarm. The broader issue was that it was so hard to imagine that a DAX 30 company could be a hollow shell, a complete fraud. And the culture aspect is hard to understand, but it does seem like the concerns and the questions that were raised were dismissed as sort of Anglo-Saxon nonsense, as an attempt to do down one of Germany's great companies.
And do you have any tips or maybe some ideas? What can we learn as the German press from your case?
I mean, an enormous amount of what I've done in my career in exposing frauds and accounting problems is simply checking the facts, going and looking at the obscure filings or the bits of paper, or doing the work which most people don't do because they assume someone else has done it. Is the company telling the truth? Is what it's saying, does what it says make sense?
Okay, Rick, I have one question for you. What I wonder is, after all the headwinds you received from Germany, even being criminally investigated and stuff, how does it feel to receive now applause also from Germany?
I'm extremely honored to receive the prize. It's a testament to, I think, the work that we did, but also the work that everyone at the Financial Times did. And really, I'm just happy that the truth finally came out. It feels like this enormous weight is lifted after all these years. And I can finally look forward to, once the book is done, to working on some other stories.